these guys had to say about each other.
Your first one is Pascoa. What do you think of Pascoa? Do you know much about him? Have you looked at his deck lists?
Look at his deck list. And I'm feeling really good about my first match versus him because I just feel my lineup's way stronger.
I'm feeling confident about the entire tournament because Rift Halen is the hardest opponent. I've heard that he didn't practice at all and he was playing World of Warcraft the last few weeks.
What I know is just basically I watched his games in prelims. This is actually what I was predicting. That's like the typical lineup.
I have like the aggro decks which are good against his lineup. He's playing almost the same list he was playing prelims. This furthers my point that he didn't practice at all because he's not bringing almost any new cards.
To me, I feel like the first match is just going to be the easiest part. I'm not stressing at all.
Because of the new cards, I think the power level of the decks went up and they're just good enough so that he can't really win.
I got that in the bag.
Welcome back to the America's Summer Championship. Bringing this next match is going to be the coolest caster to ever grace the Hearthstone scene, and also Sottl.
Thanks, buddy. It's 7 out of 10, I'd give it. Maybe like slightly predictable, but decent nonetheless.
All right. Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you very much. But these guys are far from predictable. Pascoa and Roof Trellin. Mm-hmm. But these guys have bold personalities. Pascoa can talk about the game for hours on end, right. And Roof Trellin can as well, but in a different light, I suppose.
Yeah, and Pascoa really did. I mean, I sat down with him yesterday, and we talked quite extensively, and it got to the point where he was drawing me graphs, he was talking through all these incredible statistical analysis that he's done, and he really feels like his preparation is what makes him stand out in this lineup. He thinks his level of research means that his lineup that he's brought here, he's already won the tournament before a card has even been played.
And he said he doesn't really play that much, but he talks about the game a lot. He talks about game theory a lot. He talks about decks a lot. So, Roof Trellin, on the other hand, he's a guy who just likes playing Hearthstone.
Yeah.
He's just having fun.
Yeah, he's an impossible guy to dislike. He's here because he plays stuff that he's comfortable with. He plays in his comfort zone. He's a very happy, outgoing, happy-go-lucky guy. And, you know, as Pascoa pointed out, he's brought the same lineup of decks, including this Paladin deck that's going to come up against the Freeze Mage here that he had in prelims just purely because of that level of comfort that he has.
Yeah, I don't know if it necessarily fits in sort of that lineup. We saw a dude have some success with a very similar lineup as this one. Mm-hmm. You know, sort of like the best decks with a Freeze Mage added on.
Yeah.
And it worked out. Freeze Mage is still good against these decks, but against this one, it's a little bit tough. Your game plan is more of try to kill the Paladin in a single turn.
Yes, indeed. And it's often hard for the Paladin to get a clock on you. There are not a great deal of, you know, powerful aggressive minions in this deck. Roof Trellin, in fact, is running a very light package of Death Rattles. He's just running, you know, the big boys, the Cairn and Sylvanas and Tyrion. So it can be hard to generate pressure on the Freeze Mage, but the one card that can do that that's hugely important in this matchup is Ragnaros Firelord, which Roof Trellin does have.
Yes, he has three rags in his deck. And that was the one thing that Pascoa was the most worried about was Freeze Mage might be a little bit of a tough deck to win in this game, this match, because Roof Trellin has Ragnaros in his Nazoth Paladin, he has Ragnaros in his Dragon Warrior, and he also has Ragnaros in his Control Shaman.
Yes.
So three of those suckers that you got to deal with as a Freeze Mage is not really that fun.
Yeah, but I spoke at length about Pascoa's kind of preparation going into this, and he went as far as to say that if his preparation was so good, his read on the meta in this tournament was so good, that if he had seen the other seven players' deck lists in advance, his lineup would be one card different for this tournament. One card is that Flame Strike that you see in hand. That would be a second Ice Barrier in this deck, were his words.
Yeah. Flame Strike, of course, not really seen in some of the recent builds, laughing. Player from Europe that plays on the North American servers.
Yep.
He's sort of the go-to guy for a lot of these players on Freeze Mage techs. Mm-hmm. I don't think he's put a Flame Strike in his recent build. So, I mean, if he deviates, then usually if you deviate, you're considered wrong by a lot of the community. But
right. Yeah, laughing actually kind of an idol of Pascoa, I found out earlier. He said one of his happiest moments in Hearthstone is that laughing famously does Freeze Mage analysis of prominent tournaments. He just goes back and reviews all the Freeze Mage games. Mm-hmm. And laughing called out a play for a turn that Pascoa should have played, and then Pascoa did something different. And laughing's reaction was, this is actually better. And that was apparently is the proudest moment of Pascoa's life.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I'd be proud to. I would be proud to. But looking at this game, Roof Trellin's going to try and build up some pressure. This is Now, like you said, that standard Nuzoth Paladin does run all that healing, though. The double forbidden healing, the Ivory Knights, also the Ragnaros Light Lord. So that's why you want to kill the Paladin in a single turn if you're the Freeze Mage, because if you put him to 15 with Alexstrasza, they heal back up.
Right. It really takes, you know, the two-turn, get a block up, Alexstrasza them, burn them out the next turn. It takes that standard Freeze Mage route out of the equation. But honestly, when people look at matchups against Freeze Mage, I think they overrate the power of healing against the deck. Mm-hmm. You can have all the healing you want in your deck. If you don't have pressure, they will just amass a 10-card hand, Emperor their hand, and OTK you. So, as you said, Roof Trellin right now is just, you know, throwing out a random menagerie of minions here, just trying to get any pressure that he can on the board. The important thing for him here is that he does scale into his mid-game and late-game minions quite quickly here. But as I mentioned, Rag Firelord could be the big deal in this matchup.
Yeah, that's one of the cards that allows you to put on pressure that can't be stopped.
Yes.
The 8-drops, just in general, are the cards that you sort of want to look for in this matchup. That's why Roof Trellin sort of held onto the coin there. Yeah, if you're going for the pressure part of the matchup, maybe you coin out the Ivory Knight there to try and get that rolling, or you coin out the Sylvanas, but he wants to save the coin for one of those 8-drops, whether it be Tyrion, whether it be Ragnaros Light Lord, whether it be Ragnaros the Fire Lord, because those are the cards that are sort of either applying pressure every turn or are must kills for the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, so Sylvanas in itself is a dangerous card to be playing against Freeze Mage because of the threat of Doomsayer being given to you to sweep your board. And, you know, even say in this situation coming up for Roof Trellin, like if a Doomsayer Fireball comes out here to sweep this board, he probably won't think that's too big of a deal. But the problem is that the Freeze Mage, as soon as Sylvanas on the board, has the power to just stall that Sylvanas for a turn or two, and you're forced to continue developing more minions to amass pressure, mm-hmm. and then they can choose to just flick the switch and Doomsayer Fireball, steal the Doomsayer. There goes your board.
Sort of gives your opponent a free on-demand sort of Frost Nova,
yep.
I guess.
Right.
Frost Nova Doomsayer that can't be answered. And so he's going to go ahead and play it. You know, I in this situation, if you don't have any other options besides like Hero Power or Solemn Vigil for 5, I think you sort of have to go with the Sylvanas.
He did have another option. There is another 6-mana card in his hand.
True. Yeah, that one also heals, though. So maybe he's thinking, well, if I don't draw Forbidden Healing, mm-hmm. maybe I need to use Ivory Knight as a tool to like heal for 10 with anything can happen. Even though this isn't a Zoth Paladin, it won't use it. Sometimes you can just choose it for the 10 points of heal.
Yeah, I mean, I think if it comes down to a trying to burst heal out of range of Freeze Mage, Ivory Knight is not going to be enough to get the job done. Most of the time. So, I mean, there is also the fact that Sylvanas is just one extra point of pressure, right? It's a 5-5 instead of a 4-4, so there's definitely merit to playing it. But like I said, this does just now open up a world for Pascoa where he has the free option to remove this board when he can. And he's just going to actually try and do it the old-fashioned way with the Frost Nova Doomsayer because, of course, keeping that fireball in his own hand is a very big deal for him to amass the OTK later.
Mm-hmm. He does have Blood Mage Thaunos, which is a big part of that. But other than that, besides Fireball, he has no other cards in his hand that are on that burn plan. Mm-hmm. And we'll see if Flamestrike, that card that he said was the one card he would change after seeing on the lineups, if that's going to come into play as far as this game goes.
The Pyromancer here is going to proc, taking the Doomsayer down to 6, but still no realistic option for being able to remove it. So he is just going to give up his board here, pass over a turn of initiative to Pascoa. Goes ahead and Hero Powers, because why not? But no real huge way to capitalize on the initiative here from Pascoa. He has Ice Block in his hand, but that's already developed. No Arcane Intellect to cast, no Acolyte ping play, no Loot Hoarders to develop. So it's a Doomsayer that's relieved pressure, but he hasn't been able to capitalize on the tempo initiative that goes along with it.
Which is a big deal. I mean, this turn, what is he going to do? A lot of times players would play Thanos here just to try and cycle.
Mm-hmm.
But that, since that's part of the win condition of this matchup,
yeah,
he can't do that. So
yeah.
I guess Mirror Image is just to try and block damage. Roof Trellin attacked last turn, which indicates two things. Either he wants to play Tyrion this turn, or he has second True Silver Champion in his hand.
Right.
And if he attacked last turn, I think he would play Tyrion, but I'm not sure. Maybe he just wanted to get the attack out there.
Yeah, I mean, I think from his perspective, it probably was a plan to set up Tyrion. As you mentioned, you know, Roof Trellin's already established that he is valuing his healing cards here, so playing Ragnaros Lightlord on this board for the same reason we discussed about Ivory Knight. Roof Trellin is obviously on the plan where he's going to need some healing this game, so no surprise to see the Tyrion come down here, and these mirror images just turn out to be really, really well-timed from Pascoa. They can potentially tank a lot of damage here.
Yeah, really smart stuff. but a lot, at least like 10 in this situation, the board stays the same.
Yep.
But Rooftron has so much healing in his hand. A lot. Sometimes that doesn't come into play. A lot of times with Paladin, you know, either you need the healing, or your opponent just knows what the win condition is and holds on to all their burn.
Right.
So, and I think maybe like 30%. It's a TJ stat, by the way.
Nice.
Maybe about 30%, possibly 32% of games are decided by the healing that Paladin has.
32 is pushing it. Like maybe 31. I'm not sure if we can go as far as 32.
Yeah, you're probably right.
Yeah.
I'm going to go revise.
But, yeah, I mean, yeah, it's a lot of healing, but, like, I'm looking at this hand and saying, like, that Tyrion is 15 damage after it dies. It's 3 Ashbringer swings that are going through. That Ragnaros Lightlord, sure, it's a bunch of healing, but it's also an 8-8 that's going to be able to pound him in the face pretty darn quickly. So it's also a very aggressive hand, just in terms of the amount of damage that he can pile out here, and he may just be able to get a quick enough clock on the Freeze Mage here to stop him amassing enough cards in hand.
Yeah, very true. There's one of the tech sort of cards that Rooftron does have, the Aedric to Pure. A card that doesn't really see much play, to be honest.
And I asked Rooftron about it. I was like, hey, what's this Aedric doing in here? He's I just like him. He's cool. It's a cool card. I like it.
That's Rooftron's answer for every single tech choice that he makes.
It really is.
Probably every single thing that he does in his life. You're like, why did you do that? He's like, I don't know. I liked it.
So I do wonder, like, He takes this to such extremes. You know, every time a camera has been on him over the last 2 days, he's made the effort to, you know, play up to the camera and make a face, et cetera, et cetera. I'm starting to wonder, like, how much of this is a cultivated aura? Is he trying to get people to not take him seriously? You know, it's the way the other players are talking about it, he's the Yogg guy. He's the guy that loves to play Yogg all the time. You know, is that deliberate? Is he trying to get these people to underestimate him?
Well, even by his decks, because people sort of forget about him. They say, well, you know, besides Rooftron, I should be pretty favored against most of these lineups. They forget about his lineup. They forget that one of these players has to face him in round one. Another of these players has to face him in the semifinals to even get to the finals. So maybe that's part of it. Maybe he is trying to go for that facade that he, you know, doesn't really care, and he's just going to sneak up and take wins from unsuspecting players.
But in the meantime, look who has showed up on the scene, TJ. There is the Ragnaros, and that, as you said, is just almost unanswerable pressure from the Freeze Mage. You know, they can lock out damage on board very effectively with freeze effects. Even weapons they can stall for a couple of turns with things like Mirror Image and freezing the face. Ragnaros firing off every turn, they kind of just have to throw raw damage at it to get it off the board. And in this matchup, which is a matchup very much based around the one-turn kill strategy, you have to throw 8 damage at a Ragnaros. That eats into your win rate like a huge amount.
It really does. And you know, Pasqua said, when I asked him, I said, hey, he's got 3 rags and you're a freeze mage.
Yeah.
Are you worried? He said, yeah, I'm worried, but even if I have to kill Rag, I still should be okay.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of looked at him like, are you sure you're going to be okay if you have to kill the Rag?
Right.
I mean, he does have an okay way to deal with it with Blood Mage plus Fireball.
Right, but point being, there are some matchups where Blood Mage Fireball ping on a Ragnaros is not the end of the world. The Blood Mage Fireball ping on a Ragnaros in this matchup is so much damage out of your OTK turn, because the Fireball's gone and the Blood Mage is gone. And the Blood Mage itself represents 5 or 6 damage depending on what combination you're throwing together for your one-turn kill. So it's such a phenomenal investment.
And now Rooftron is going to pop the block. It is going to be at 8, though. So, you know, not the best in the world, but still pretty good. Maybe he'll consider. No, he's already attacked, so there's no way for him to do it. Like less, I guess he's just gonna get more on the board.
Yeah, I mean this is brilliant. Honestly, it's just he realizes that this rag has to be dealt with raw damage, so now he's just even taking that option further out of the equation, saying you have to invest even more damage into this rag.
Now it's basically unkillable, especially since Pasqua has to develop second ice block here.
Ooh. That Frostbolt is potentially a really big deal. So Emperor Iceblock this turn now hits, what, 4 burn spells and a Blood Mage Thaunos?
Yeah.
So we'll be looking at, what, 9 damage plus 8, 17 damage plus the 4 from the Blood Mage 21 and a ping. I mean, he's not quite there. It's not going to be able to push him through over the 2 turns, and he will definitely lose his second block on the following turn if he goes to that line. So he's going to have to find something a little bit better. Does he have top deck outs if he goes down that line?
I don't think so. Because of a 22 damage, including the ping, even with Blood Mage, a top-decked Fireball would, which he's already used one,
mm-hmm.
or a top deck. I don't think he's used a Forgotten Torch so far this game, so it doesn't seem like there's any outs. Frostbolt probably the most damage that's left in his deck that he could reasonably fit in with that combo. And that'd only be an extra four, so it'd still be quite a ways off the mark. Unless Emperor hits. Maybe they're... No. Yeah.
I mean, the Emperor never connects, right? Yeah. It just gets traded into exactly. By the minions. He passes turn. Ragnaros does the work for him. So. Yeah. It's a rough situation for sure, and Roof Trellin is just sat on an absolute embarrassment of riches in his hand, honestly. Like, even if this game was to stretch out from this point, he still has plenty of gas to keep going. So.
He barely has had to even use any of his healing yet. I mean, he hasn't even had to play Ragnaros the Lightlord. It seemed like most just his early minions plus his hits with like true Silver Champions have been what have won him this game. And I mean, now he's just going to play Ragnaros Lightlord, but it's not even needed at this stage. Second block is going to be popped, and Pasqua needs a miracle. I don't think there's anything in his deck that's going to save him.
Yeah, I don't see it unless I've counted the damage wrong on the previous turn. I just don't even see the outs that he's playing to right now. Ragnaros Lightlord as well, just doing his work. Nothing to heal, but he's gonna show off anyway. Second Frostbolt, I just don't think does the job here. Pascoa hasn't immediately reacted to it as if that was the out he needed, so he's in a mess. Defensive Alexstrasza and freeze something on the board. Is this a line that ever wins the game?
He has 26 damage with his burn spells, but if he freezes... Oh, no, he has a 2-mana Frost Nova. So maybe...
I bring life. And have, yeah, I mean, he does still have the ice barrier up, right? So, I mean, from his perspective, I guess there is a world where he now wins the game, but it's just not going to be good enough. There's plenty of options to remove this in hand. Roof Trellin goes for Stampeding Kodo for the flourish. And Roof Trellin, a long and grueling game one, but one that goes to the happy-go-lucky, cheerful little character himself.
That's Roof Trellin. Yeah, and that just shows the matchup. As soon as Rag came down the board, it limited Pasqua's options completely. So Roof Trellin's going to take game number one. Pasqua's got to fight back. Pasqua is the first Brazilian player to qualify for a championship event for the 2016 season. And I sat down and talked with him a little bit about sort of his run to get here.
You're the first Brazilian player to qualify for a championship. All year, you're the first one. So how does it feel to be the first Brazilian player in the championship?
Well, it's just cool to be here representing Brazil. Like, I think a lot of the Brazilian players don't think I'm good enough to represent Brazil. I think they aren't good enough as well, so I think it would be really cool for me to play against strong players. This was the first prelims I was playing. I was playing just with the expectations of practicing for next year.
So what's the esports scene like in Brazil?
There are a lot of pretty good players. I wouldn't say top level players because in Brazil the teams don't give enough money to people to play. So it's hard to focus only on Hearthstone. You have to focus on doing college or working and stuff. But there's a lot of great players like Koglaring, Raze. If Brazil can win something, then the sponsors maybe can look at Brazil and make a lot of more investments into teams. And maybe it would mean that the Brazil will be a really huge thing in the future.
We'll say that interviewer is very handsome and talented.
I agree with that assessment entirely, TJ. I don't know who that man is, but he's a man, a myth, and a legend. And I would be honored to be casting with him instead of you, but unfortunately we can't always get what we want.
He deserves praise and gifts. That's all I have to say. But game number two is coming up next for Pasqua and Roof Trellin. Roof Trellin has a 1-0 lead, taking the win with N'Zoth Paladin over Freeze Mage. See if these guys are going to queue up for game number two, but that was the deck that Pasqua was worried about. He was worried about the Freeze Mage against some of these slower decks, which in the past it seemed like Freeze Mage was the one who beat the slower decks, but now it seems like it's there more for the faster decks.
It's true. And I wonder how much of it becomes the heart ruling the head for Pascoa in this one, you know, crucial element, because as we said, he's very statistics driven, very preparation driven. He says he's brought the best lineup in the tournament. But Freeze Mage is a pet deck of his. It's his favorite deck. It's a deck that, you know, he plays a ton. You know, his idols in Hearthstone are people like Laughing. So has that choice to bring Freeze Mage to this tournament, has he overruled his own, you know, preparation strategy and just followed his heart for that one moment? Could that be the downfall for him in this series?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. A lot of players or a lot of people in the world will tell you to follow your heart. But so perhaps in Hearthstone, it's not the right thing to do.
These people are incorrect. Your heart is an idiot, DJ. If your heart knew anything, it would be a brain.
It's the best quote I've heard in a long, long time. But yeah, this next game is going to be the Zoo Warlock, ranked 2 legend with in July, with a few tweaks. You know, added Babbling Books because the card came out. But what do you think of this matchup, Sal?
It's gone back and forth, honestly. I mean, recently Asmodai got rank 1 legend, you know, my teammate on Complexity with a Tempo Mage list as well, and he was playing Arcane Explosion in his deck because of Shaman and Zoo specifically. The card that he doesn't have in place of that, though, is Mirror Image, which you can see here is doing a ton of work for Roof Trellin to allow him essentially to dictate the trades, right? Like, this is a play that would confuse every single Hearthstone player in 2014, where you just play Mirror Image and it dies on the board and you lose a card. But the greater implication of it list these days, which Roof Trellin is, in fact. So there's a difference in the lineups there as well. But yeah, like you said, that Inner Rage particularly has kind of floated around the deck for a little while. But Pasqua just said that he's really a big fan of the tempo pushes that you can make with it, just dealing that one source of damage on the board early on, or using it with Azir Drake as a tempo swing in the mid game. So he is definitely a fan of it as a tempo tool and a board control tool more than, you know, just a straight up Grommash activator. But we'll see how it works for him in this matchup. Of course, this matchup is one of the very reasons for Tempo Mage's resurgence recently. It's, you know, the high percentage of Dragon Warrior on ladder. These Tempo Mages have come out and just really been able to leverage exactly these kinds of opening hands to just grab initiative way too early for the Dragon Warrior to come back.
True, yeah. Fiery War Axe and Fairy Dragon both sort of put a stop to Tempo Mages, though.
Yep.
So that's the hand that you want if you want to combat something like this, but it's still tough. Because a lot of times, Tempo Mages, they're developing something and they're killing something, which is usually what Dragon Warrior tries to do, but just at a much slower pace.
I think you just defined tempo.
Whoa!
Brian Kibler would be so proud.
So sick. And going back to the Inner Rage pick as well, Inner Rage also is sort of a psychological aspect. There was a concept that was first shown to me by the great British philosopher George C.
I so knew that was coming, and it was still funny.
And he brought Leroy Jenkins and some really unsuspecting lists to his run through the spring preliminary, where he eventually qualified for the championship. He had, and he said it wasn't necessarily for bursting people for six with one card with Leroy Jenkins. It was mostly so that people were always afraid of Leroy Jenkins, and the fact that people would make suboptimal turns like once or twice throughout a game because they were afraid of Leroy would win him more games than Leroy by itself would. And it's the same concept with Inner Rage. In a format like this where people know exactly what cards you have in your lineup, having to play around 12 damage from turn 8 on is a really big deal.
Right, and there's kind of a cognitive trap in Hearthstone, and I guess card games in general, where you feel like if you are playing around more things, you are playing better, right? If you are considering more of your opponent's options and preventing them from being powerful, then you are a more accomplished player. You're assessing your options in a more deep way. But the fact of the matter is just percentage-wise, most of the time they don't have those specific things. So the real top-tier players will understand when it's correct to not play around cards.
Next level thinking is what it's all about. And so we'll see if that's going to affect the outcome of this match at all. Roof Trellin, though, has a pretty good turn here. He's going to get multiple minions online. He's going to develop stuff. He's going to kill stuff. He's going to create some tempo here. Mm-hmm. And Pasqua, outside of Alishas's champion, doesn't have a way to immediately answer things on the board.
Yeah, and since the Mana Worm immediately gets buffed up to 3 power here, there isn't even a value trade for the Alex Charles as champion on the board. So, again, this is just kind of what Tempo Mage does in this matchup. You know, there's so many great 4 health targets in particular for that combination that you just saw, the Cult Sorcerer Arcane Blast. You know, you're looking at Fierce Monkeys and Frothing Berserkers and Azure Drakes, Blackwing Corruptors. All these things go down to that combination. So they're able to grab the board through that and other synergies in their deck so efficiently that Pasqua is the Dragon Warrior will find himself in this sort of situation more often than not, where he's having to fight back onto a board, where he's staring down a couple of minions and he has nothing in play, and that is not what Dragon Warrior wants to be doing.
No, not at all. And Tempo Mage, though, one of the things we talked about sort of in Zoo, but you know, it's relevant across most matchups, is they do run out of cards. Mm-hmm. And I know we're both sort of in the camp that we generally dislike Cabalist Tome in Temple Mage, but Cabalist Tome, when you have a good early hand, can be great because it allows you to reload much faster than other things. But we'll have to see if that's going to play into effect. Rivchella now just sort of playing his stuff and just taking advantage of the fact that he has near complete control over this early board.
Yeah, I mean, if he was to draw a Cabalist Tome in the next turn or two here, then it would be fantastic for him. You know, it's similar to a point you made in the Zoo matchup where it's like, you know, when you lose the board, how much initiative have you pushed? How much damage have you caused to your opponent? It's the same sort of thing, you know, in that matchup as well. If you've been able to grab the board early, it's, you know, how much board control have you been able to achieve? Because sometimes you're going to draw these slow, clunky cards that you have in your deck, like the Cabalist Tomes, and if you've fallen behind already by that point, then they're devastatingly bad, but they're fantastic as reload engines.
For sure, for sure. Another couple interesting things about Rivchellan's Tempo Mage list is that he runs a Polymorph,
yes,
which is very interesting. He thinks that it's really good against Dragon Warrior, because against Dragon Warrior, you'll almost always find a big target for it, because they just like to curb out with minions. It doesn't run many spells. He also runs Archmage Antonitis, which a lot of times is quite the opposite. It's a card that sits dead in your hand or sometimes against Dragon Warrior, because either you don't get a good early start and they beat you, or you do get a good early start and you're sort of top-decking Archmage Antonitis without many spells to combo with it.
Mm-hmm. And we saw that in the previous game versus Zoo, where he was just stuck with an Antonitis in his hand that, you know, would have been better served as any kind of removal tool or stalling tool, really. But, you know, Antonitis is another tool that can turn Cabalist Tome into something that does something, right? My problem with Cabalist Tome is very often just 5-mana do nothing, but if you're also playing the Emperor Antonitis package at the top of your curve, you at least have the chance to, you know, turn Shatters into something useful later on, although we saw some pretty spectacular Shatters used in previous series.
Most people will say, what can you get that's bad from Cabalist Tome? Oh, Shatter? Yeah, well, not sometimes. Okay, Azure Drake is actually really good here because it allows him to have that reload. And if he picks up an Arcane Blast, oh boy, not quite.
Yeah, Flame Strike again. Out to gain access to quite a few more here with the Curator, a deck that was just responsible in a way for the rich getting richer in Karazhan, with Dragon Warrior getting one of the most powerful cards here, just a natural fit for one of the strongest decks in the meta already.
It did encourage some changes, but they were very small. In the ways of subbing out a Frothing Berserker for a Fierce Monkey, or, you know, something else in your deck for a second Fierce Monkey. A lot of times it was in that sixth slot. Mm-hmm. And the seventh spot in Warrior was already a spot that was kind of toyed with. People were playing Malkorok for a while, but that ended up being really inconsistent. So, yeah, it did feel like Curator was just a natural fit for the deck.
Yeah, that was not the Flame Strike that Rivchellan was looking for in this matchup. Just kind of forced into it based on the awkward nature of his hand. Just to reset the board, he has drawn Yogg-Saron here, which gives him, you know, a sense of inevitability, at least if he can just pile together some spells over the next couple of turns. He knows that he praises Yogg more than any man I've ever met, based on what he's told me. So I'm sure that old god in his hand is giving him a certain amount of security right now.
He calls Yogg-Saron his good buddy, is how Rivchellan phrases it. And if you talk to the other players in the tournament, you said it earlier on, they know him as the Yogg guy. And they'll go around, they say, well, what are you worried about in the Rivchellan match? Well, I'm worried about his Yoggs.
Yeah. And there it is, as he highlights it for us. He's just waiting to slam that thing on the board. But right now there is a Flame Waker in play that didn't have wonderful answers. But in terms of wonderful answers for 2/4s, Corcron Elite coming into the hand from the right-hand side for Pasqua is pretty much ideal in this situation.
Yeah, we'll just get pinged off the following turn, but Pasqua trying to think about what is going to be the best option for this turn. He knows that Rivchellan only runs a single copy of Flamestrike, so he can sort of feel free to flood the board in a way. He's seen the card that was received from Babbling Book. He hadn't seen a Cabal's Tome, but he won't have enough mana to play Cabal's Tome plus a board sweep, so
sure.
He could sort of go, not all in, but he can go pretty aggressive with the board state in this situation.
Yeah, I mean, it's basically just a consideration of, you know, Pascal will feel comfortable and he'll think that, you know, there's two ways I'm going to lose this game. One is just consistent burn being drawn, you know, a ridiculous combination of burn spells from a Cabalist Tome plus a Fireball being drawn the next turn because he is relatively low on health. And the other way is just, you know, hashtag Yogg game. That's the other way he's going to lose this game. So those are the two things that he has to consider moving forward and how to mitigate those two outcomes.
I really like this play from Pasqual because he knew that Ruchon's hand was kind of dead. It's only got one card. So he knew that Ruchon was going to be pinging next turn almost always.
Yeah.
And so he protected his board against pings. He made it so that nothing on his board was vulnerable to getting pinged off. And so at the Corcoran Elite trade, he decided to go with something a little bit more fancy and leave the Corcoran Elite at 3 health and leave the rest of his board at 2.
Yeah, makes sense. So here we go. He's just gaining himself a little bit of armor there. Now going to Finley try and pick up something. Fire Blast and Lesser Heal here. Much of a muchness. He's going to take the Fire Blast, but Lesser Heal there was definitely had some value to protect some of the low health minions that he has on board here. But he takes the Fire Blast and, well, here we go.
All right, let's see if Yogg-Saron really is his good buddy. Lava Shock is an okay start, I suppose. Savagery, Lava Burst. Well, he's clearing the board.
Not low enough on life for that revenge to be the sweep that he would need, and that is a disappointing Yogg-Saron. As most have been in this tournament so far, it has to be said.
Yeah, he really didn't cast that many spells. Was that a 5-spell Yogg-Saron?
Right.
So not quite the early start they would have hoped for. He's put a lot of minions this game. He does, however, tracking into a Cabal's Tome. But the rough thing about Yogg-Saron and tracking is that you actually don't know which cards
he
got rid of. So it's kind of a negative effect in a way, because if you're looking for outs,
yeah,
you don't know if that out is even still in your deck.
Yeah. I mean, I've had the situation come up numerous times where after a Yogg has been cast, you know, I'm down to the last two or three cards in my deck, and it's like, oh, I win. I still have a swipe left. Like, this guy's just dead, and I draw the rest of my deck, and there's no swipe there. I'm like, what happened? Oh, it cast tracking. Damn you, Yogg.
Yeah.
And then I disenchant Yogg and remove it from all my decks.
Thus is the life of Sottl.
Yeah.
But Cabal's Tome is actually a pretty good pickup because it does give him that reload. So, I mean, it depends what he discarded, of course. Probably hoping for the second Cabal's Tome. I don't even know what else he'd like to discard at this stage. But Pasqual just sort of running away with this game unless Ruchon picks up something crazy.
Yeah, I'm going to say, is Cabal's Tome really what he's looking for here? I mean, can he spend 5 mana on doing nothing this turn? It just really doesn't look like he's going to have time.
Well, he didn't discard the second one.
He could spend 10 mana on doing nothing, TJ.
That
is phenomenal.
Incredibly efficient.
It is.
Well, Ice Barrier, let's see, that'll bring him up to 15 effectively, and there is 7 plus a 6 on the board, which is 13, 14 with the ping. So he will be alive. He could take 3 damage off the board with the ping or 4 damage off the board with the Frostbolt. So still alive, I suppose.
Mm-hmm. Fiery War Axe picked up is a lot of damage over the next 2 turns. Not enough to get the job done just yet. 9, 10, 13 damage. Ruchon is at effective 15. But from Pasqual's perspective, he's considering all the various secret options here. Gets the news very quickly that it's Ice Barrier. So I'm sure he's just going to push through damage as rapidly as possible here. He knows the Yogg is gone. He knows there's no way that 20 is going to be dealt from hand here, even with the Cabalist Tome being cast and increasing the range of outs for Ruchon. And Ruchon is, again, probably just going to have to dig into the bag of tricks here with Cabalist Tome and try and pick up something that does more than stall for a turn like the Ice Barrier did.
Well, here we go. 5 more mana and another Cabalist Tome. Oh, my goodness.
15 entire mana spent on doing precisely 0.
Babbling Book, a second Dragon's Breath. Not going to be helpful in this situation. Won't even be able to get it down to enough mana. He's going to get rid of his own Babbling Book, not happy with the card that it gave him.
Yep, just punish that book. It's like, no, that was not the card I was looking for. I don't know, he was desperately trying to cast one of those Dragon's Breath that turn by killing as many minions as possible. Mm-hmm. But didn't work out that way. And Pascual, after the slow start, the unfortunate matchup with the freeze mage, which, as you said, could be a sticking point for him, he's climbed his way back into this series.
Yeah, Pascual, a player who's very new to the competitive Hearthstone scene. And I had a chance to sit down and talk with him about what motivated him to actually get started.
January, I started dating this girl. We broke up like in April. It was a short relationship. Play a difficult deck, perform well with it when you're in a huge stage, you know? And he told me that he likes to emote and scream and do things to release the anxiety because he has anxiety as well. So I just tried that in the tournament. I just started talking to myself. I started screaming between the games, like, yay, nice, I finally got it, and stuff. I tried to do the emote things, like he told me. The first game, the turn one against Rosie, I said hello, and he didn't answer. Then I said hello again, and he said hello, and I said thank you, and stuff. So I kind of did this stuff to release my anxiety, and it really helped. When you're at a specific environment, and you're feeling kind of bad in this environment, you just change the environment, or change your head, or, I don't know, change the way you're thinking about the environment. Can feel better over time.
Hearthstone is a mender of broken hearts.
It's a really feel-good story, and you know, I spoke to him in some more detail about that, and he really did feel like he was in a bad place, you know, earlier on in the year. And you know, Hearthstone very, very directly is a contributor to managing his anxiety. He finds thinking about the game, theorizing about the game, visualizing board states and how you play through these matchups, he finds it directly a very relaxing thing to do. And he really does have this Hearthstone, you know, thought palace, honestly, to an extent. He has played the game, actually, in terms of like ranked wins on his account, like less than anyone else here, I think. But he says that, you know, he's visualized thousands and thousands of games and theory-crafted matchups.
A thought palace, you say?
Yes. Are you familiar with the Sherlock Holmes thought palace?
Mm-mm. Mm. But funny thing, what would your thought palace look like, Sunil?
It would just be a black den of misery.
With flames and pitchforks.
That's right.
Well, I hope you can go there to relieve your stress as well. But yeah, on a big stage like this, it's probably a good thing to use Hearthstone as a stress reliever, because this is probably a very stressful environment for these players being at this stage of a championship. Not only are they playing for semifinals, they're also playing for moving up on that prize pool, totem pole as well. So getting more and more money the further up they go, getting closer and closer to the world championship the further up they go.
Yeah, and I think the closer and closer it gets for Pascual, the realer it will get. You know, he mentioned in his media piece earlier, and when I spoke to him as well, that you know, he was really viewing this whole experience going into the preliminary as a training experience. Get yourself in a good position for next year, and then that'll be my big push at a Hearthstone Championship Tour event. But now being here, I spoke to him as like, okay, now you're here, is this any more real? Like, are you still here to learn, or are you now here to win? And he's like, well, you know, I'm three games away from BlizzCon, right? Like, this is very real in my eyes. So suddenly, as he does climb up that prize pool ladder, as you said, and get closer and closer, suddenly the looming stage, the bright lights of BlizzCon are very bright in his eyes.
He's got a 2-1 lead in this series. So this is the matchup between probably the two weak links in both of these players' lineups, as far as performance goes, and also as far as, you know, just their perception. Pascual said the Freeze Mage would be sort of the toughest matchup against Rooftrellin specifically, because of the slower control decks with Ragnaros that he had. And Rooftrellin, even though this list has taken him to very high, you know, legend ranks, a tournament environment is different, and we have seen it fall flat on its face, not only here, but also in some of the matches at the preliminary.
Yep. So now, with the second Mana Worm hitting the board, the Doomsayer in the opening hand, which is usually so huge against these decks that are trying to tempo out early onto the board, is a scary proposition, because Frostbolt answers it. Arcane Blast plus Ping answers it. The specific hand of Rooftrellin, which just puts a bunch more Hearthstone cards into his hand, does not answer it right now, but Pascual is not able to know that. Of course, from his perspective, he'll be terrified that this Doomsayer is way too fragile right now.
sort of a high-risk, high-reward type of play.
It
where
is.
If you play Doomsayer and it gets answered, all of a sudden you have two mana worms that are now a lot larger than they would have been. But if you try and save it for, say, a Frost Nova combination, it also just gives Roof Trellin more time to find an answer to a Doomsayer, whether it be like a Fireball or Paladin Book and Cabal's Tome into something crazy. So it really is a tough decision to make, and maybe Pascoa is going to think that this is going to be the only time or the best time where Roof Trellin may not have an answer.
And Roof Trellin is going to believe here. He has 5 damage from the Mana Worms and the Ping, so he needs 2 shots on that. Doomsayer does not get it. That is an Arcane Missiles thrown into the ether, the full Dennis Missiles to face in the end.
Wonder where Dennis is today.
I wonder that every day.
Every single day, wake up. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, if you're going to miss the Doomsayer the 2 times, it's better that all the shots go to
Correct.
Face.
Correct, yes. That is the second best outcome.
So yeah, so Roof Trellin can be pretty happy about that fact. But, you know, clearing the Doomsayer would have been much better, I think. But, you know, this matchup is about sort of being aggressive as the Temple Mage. A lot of times you win by just going face. And, you know, sometimes that's off the back of early minions getting in hits. But this time it's going to have to be with just Roof Trellin getting things done with burn spells, I suppose.
Yeah, and just going all the way back to the decision to play Doomsayer in the first place, you know, we both mentioned how Pasquare is a very statistics-driven player. He says that a lot of people aren't really considering probabilities properly in this game, and you know that decision to play the Doomsayer is very much a probability-based decision, right? It's how likely are they to have it versus how much does it impact my win rate either way, and he came out with a decision to take the risk. Roof Trellin chose to take a risk himself, and only one of those players got paid out as Pascoa right now. And Azure Drakes just seem to be breaking our game, TJ.
People playing them just a little bit too quickly. And double Cabal Stone being stuck in the hand, maybe there was some merit to thinking about that a little bit longer and going with Cabal Stone over Azure Drake. But getting bodies on the board is incredibly important against Freeze Mage, because even though you're sort of on the burn plan, minions make the burn plan much easier.
Yes, they do. So Secret Developer, Darklight of Pain going to come down. Pasquale obviously feels like he has all the time in the world right now, doesn't feel the need to overreact to this Azure Drake. And still those two Cabalist Tomes stuck in the hand, but the pickup of the Drake specifically means that he has found himself some extra fuel and now can at least play the Cabalist Tome for a discount. Picks up Shatter. Everyone is getting Shatters from these Tomes, but gets a block of his own, which is actually a really potentially big deal in this matchup.
Yeah, I think it's a huge deal, because a lot of times Freeze Mage will have trouble putting you at 1 before they kill you. You know, they're going to use a big chunk of burn. And that means that Pasquale is not only going to have an extra turn to beat Roof Trellin, he's also going to have an extra burn spell to get him closer to be able to pop the block. Unless, you know, he can plan around it. If he understands that it's ice block early, he can, you know, properly plan his burn. But, you know, there might be a little bit of a game going on there where Roof Trellin's going to try and hold on to it till the last minute to throw Pasquale off. But that can be impactful. Arcane Missiles can be impactful. But, man, Shatter is not going to find its third use today.
Whoa, don't speak too soon, TJ. There is another Cabalist Tome yet to be cast. We can pick up some sweet, sweet Shatter synergy yet.
Yeah, on all 4 of the minions that it could even hit in this matchup.
Dude, we're going to see a Doomsayer get Frost Nova Shattered. That's what we're going to see this game.
It would be possible.
Yep.
It is possible. Well, Pasquale going to think about it for a long time, but opt to go with Blizzard here. Not too many options other than using Burn or just drawing a bunch of cards.
Speaking of Burn, I think it's time to go if you are Roof Trellin here. And yeah, I love this line. Flamewaker, Sorcerer's Apprentice. Arcane Int pushes through. Any 2 or 1 mana spells that get drawn are playable here. Arcane Blast, not exactly perfect since it's lacking a target, but nonetheless a ton of damage.
Could shatter his own Azure Drake for 2 extra damage here.
Do it.
Oh my goodness. Is it going to happen the turn after I said it?
Shatter value. 1 mana, 2 damage.
If it's... Okay. I was going to say, it depends on whether or not you think your opponent pinging next turn is going to be impactful to their turn. Forcing Pasquale to ping off the Azure Drake means he only has 6 mana available. Mm-hmm. And if you expect like Coin Alexstrasza to come out,
yep.
Which he is a popular play. It's not like that's a fringe case scenario. That's a popular play. If Freeze Mage just hold on to the coin, then keeping the Azure Drake alive is much more important than pushing two extra damage.
Yeah, I totally agree with keeping the Drake alive, and I think your explanation there is spot on. That 4-1 Drake on the board is a nightmare for Pascual right now, because this period of the game where you are being threatened for lethal as the Freeze Mage, your mana usage is so tight, right? Even if you didn't have the coin Alexstrasza play available to you this turn, these turns towards the end of the game where you're trying to scramble, you very often have to lock out the board and try and draw some cards and try and set up a win condition for yourself on a following turn. So you very often just don't have time to weave in a ping there. So the value of a 4-1 on the board is actually pretty high right now.
Well, Pascual thinking about sort of his options here, and I don't think he can go with the coin Alexstrasza, so just going to go with the, I'm going to remove some stuff on the board, and, you know, we're chilling. Leaving the Azure Drake alive, forcing out the ping, pretty crucial to the overall gameplay, but Sorcerer's Apprentice being left alive.
Ooh.
And he's going to be able to pop at one.
Yes, he is. Those two fireballs are going to go through. You can even take care of the Blood Mage since we have the ping available. And, oh, never mind. There is a barrier in play.
Uh-oh. That was a barrier, not a block.
Uh-oh.
I thought it was a block, too.
Yeah, me too. Same. Roof Trellin.
Pascual sold that one. Oh, my goodness. That's huge. If he had just pinged and then traded the Sorcerer's Apprentice in, that would have been game.
Yep, of course, Ice Barrier only procs on physical damage. So if Roof Trellin had just chosen to finish the game with the ping to face there instead of the Sorcerer's Apprentice, the game would be over.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose he never really had a chance to attack in with a minion, since he had effectively just played all his minions last turn and his Azure Drake was frozen.
Yep.
In my mind, and probably in his mind as well, he figured, wow, I had minions on the board last turn that survived. So I must have checked for Ice Barrier.
Yeah, sure.
And he probably fell into the trap of, you know, assuming that it was Ice Block based off of the sort of the lines of play from Pascual. But a little bit punished in the end. Now he's got to find extra burn, whereas otherwise it would have been a win. And now Pascual can Alexstrasza defensively go back up to 19.
Yep, not just an Alex to 15, an Alex to 19 because of that additional armor that got procced. And that is not a bad tome, you have to say. Firelands Portal and Frostbolt being picked up for extra reach. But now the secret is going to be developed. Of course, Roof Trellin is the mage player to play an Ice Block this game. Pascual, as the Freeze Mage, has not done so. And then, boom, TJ, there is your shatter that I quote will not get value this game.
I didn't say that.
check the VODs. Do it now.
You said it.
Our voices are fairly distinctive, TJ. I don't think there'll be too much confusion as to where that quote come from.
No. That's 3 for 3 on Shatters.
That is.
Today. That is actually absurd.
Shatter has been a more effective card in this tournament than Yogg-Saron.
It has.
Fact.
Is that enough damage? We have 8, 11, 14, 15.
8 plus 6? 14, 15, yep. I agree with your count. So he is 1 damage off. Roof Trellin, who has missed lethal this game, through the same mistake that both of us moronic casters made of not realizing that it was a barrier and not an ice block, but looks like Trellin here is just going for the setup. He has more burn in his hand. He can push through this next turn. If that all goes wrong, he even has the final push with Yogg to try and secure himself a lethal, and Pascual is going to have to really scramble here to find himself a way out.
I think this is going to be the only way, unless he wants to, say, fireball his own loot hoarder, which doesn't seem like really the case. He's going to have to use the coin.
No, he didn't.
He did not. No, he's at 8 cards now, so Arcane Elect still would have left him with 1. And still not finding. I guess he's not dead yet.
He is not, no. That is only 6 damage being faced down by the portal and the ping.
There are 3 charge minions. Oh, whoa!
Snap call Yogg from Roof Trellin. Roof Trellin is just passing the buck here. It's like, all right, I miss lethal this game. Yogg, I'm sure you can do a better job. You get it done for me, buddy.
Uh-oh. This is...
That is a healing wave.
This is a 50% chance to go wrong. At least he didn't win the joust, so it'd be 7. But 7 is a lot!
Okay. Oh, dodged.
Drain life. Does nothing.
Eye for an eye could be
a big deal. But pretty much everything else that's been cast so far has been inconsequential. He does draw some cards, however, and that is a good thing.
Yeah, the Excavated Evil is actually slightly important because it puts a whiff into Pasquale's deck where he's really desperately digging for that card right there, the Ice Block, to buy him some extra turns here. But still, having used Alexstrasza defensively already this game, there is now an Eye for an Eye in play that Pasquale knows about because a second copy was cast, which would have revealed the secret to him. He is going to ping to activate it in the most harmless way possible. He's going to try and find his block, but how does he deal 29 here over the course of just two more turns?
And he also has to worry about the ice block. It's a near impossible situation for Pasquale. I might even say it is an impossible situation for Pasquale. He secrets out the best that he could, but unfortunately, I don't think there's any way he comes out on top of this one. He needs to draw a second ice block and a bunch of burn, but he would need to pop the block like this turn.
Yeah.
This following turn.
Right. And Roof Trellin, guaranteed pop here with the missiles, no matter how the damage is rationed out. Picks up more reach in his own hand with the fireball, so he can see the way the clock develops in this matchup. Roof Trellin just going through the motions here, has this game locked up, and it looks like we're heading very rapidly towards a tied series.
And Pasquale, once again, continues to struggle with the Freeze Mage against this lineup from Roof Trellin. So it's going to be interesting to see how he's going to be able to come back. I mean, up next he's got Token Druid, which, you know, has pretty good matchups against Freeze Mage.
Yeah.
And then his final deck being a Control Shaman, which has Ragnaros and a lot of healing, similar to the Paladin. So it's going to be interesting. But Roof Trellin is really fun guy, and he likes to make people happy and be incredibly eccentric. And I had a chance to ask him about just that.
You're very expressive when you're playing on screen.
Yeah, I never take anything too seriously. I like to have fun with whatever I try to do. You know, I like to make people happy. If I was able to go to BlizzCon, that would be like kind of like a dream come true, because it's something I've always wanted to go to. Like, I feel like if I got there, I could win pretty easily. I've played a lot of Hearthstone. I'm pretty much on the top level of gameplay. I wouldn't say I'm the best in the world, but I'm pretty close. The way I see it, I go in, win three games, take my cash, head to BlizzCon. I feel like the first match is just going to be the easiest part. I'm not stressing at all about the first match. I got that in the bag.
It's a good attitude.
What inspires you when you build decks?
When I play, I want to be having fun. Like, I don't just play to do well. Like, and to me, fun is having different games, not always having like the same experiences. I'm a big fan of the RNG elements. When you have the random elements, anything can happen. Every game's a different game.
Are the naming of your decks significant?
Yeah, I name my decks after my friends.
Can I be on one of your decks?
Yeah.
Really?
Gladly. You're a good friend, Tej.
Can I build a deck with my name on it?
Yeah.
That has to stay a legacy deck for the rest of eternity?
It would be an honor.
For those wondering, the deck that I built, Roof Trellin, was a pure, unadulterated aggro shaman.
Ooh.
That will stay in his list till the end of eternity. A deck that he adamantly hates.
You troll, TJ. You deep dug, twisted man. How could you do that to such a happy, fun-loving guy?
I feel so bad, but so good at the same time. But about to jump into game number 5 of the series. It's all tied up 2-2. So both these players seem to be very evenly matched, but their deck lists are not evenly matched.
No, they have very, very different stances on how you play this game. Pasquale is really, really happy just bringing the best stuff. You know, he's gone through the statistical analysis. He trusted his read on what people were going to bring to this tournament, and he thinks he has the powerhouse lineup in the tournament. Whereas Roof Trellin is just like, hey, these are the decks I like. These are the decks that I play well. These are the decks that have been successful for me in the past. So I'm going to keep bringing them. And right now, we can't really pick a winner between those two strategies because we are sat at 2-2.
Yeah, and sort of some of their style is going to come out in the final two matchups. The final two decks for Rook Trellin are the Token Druid, and it's much different than what we've seen so far today. It's got like double Wisps of the Old Gods. It's got the Onyxia, the double Savage Roar. So it's sort of an old style Druid, and Druid of the Claw, which we haven't seen very often.
Yeah, and it has 0% Arcane Giant content. There is literally no Arcane Giants in this deck, which I find baffling. He's playing double Savage Roar, he's playing Druid of the Claws, he's playing these kind of cards instead of Arcane Giants in the deck. This is a very old school, you know, throwback Jackie Chan style Token Druid deck, whereas Pascoa moved forward with the more modern Malagos form of the deck.
Yeah, and it's the Malagos form that does not have the Violet Teachers. It's sort of the purest of Malagos Druid decks. Runs a Moonglade Portal. It runs double Mire Keeper and the Gadgetzan Auctioneer, I believe.
Yep, one Gadgetzan, every possible ramp card. But yeah, double Wild Growth, double Innovate, Emperor, and double Nourish. And then it has three of the Burst Heal cards, so two Feral Rage and one Moonglade Portal.
Yes. So it's the most Malagos that you can possibly be. It's going to be interesting to see how these two decks line up, because the Malagos Druid wants a lot of time, and they get a lot of time by having a lot of ramp and a lot of removal. And Roof Trellin's deck can get on the board fast, and if it is on the board in a big way for a single turn, it can capitalize on that with Savage Roar. So Pascual has to be very careful about how he navigates some of these turns.
He does, and it's Roof Trellin that's come out here with the power play, Violet Teacher hitting the board on turn two that he can now leverage with follow-up spells. Pascoa picked up the Innovate off his Raven Idol on the previous turn that he can use to drop a Mire Keeper, but that is just an instant blowout on the backswing with the Wrath from Roof Trellin.
Yeah, definitely, sir. Sure.
Was that another attempt at a British accent, TJ? Because if so, we are going to have to call a halt to this very quickly.
No, that was a contemplative accent.
Okay.
Very confusing with British accents, especially for British people. I understand. Don't worry.
Thanks.
But yeah, Mire Keeper, that's one of those things. Going to help him ramp up and buy him some more time. The more mana you have for removal, the more time you get to get to the Malagos.
So it looks like Roof Trellin's first thought there was just dropping the second Violet Teacher on the board and picking up a value trade with the 3-5. And it looks like that is what he's going to go for here. Just maximum tempo, maximum initiative. And I kind of like this, honestly. This is Roof Trellin evaluating that although this is a Druid mirror between similar decks, he is the aggro in this matchup. It is on him to get the board presence, be the beatdown, and really push through initiative. So I like the high tempo initiative play here from Roof Trellin.
Also might be trying to get out of swipe in not as good of a situation, but Pascoa is no stranger to playing against this deck. Those swipes are premium removal against a deck that runs two Violet Teachers and double Wisps of the Old Gods. If you don't have a swipe when Wisps comes down, you can just lose the game on the follow.
Definitely so. Now both Violet Teachers have bitten the dust, which means that the swipe is reserved purely for that Wisp of the Old Gods. But we do see that Power of the Wild picked up here, so be interesting to see Roof Trellin's long-term plans for that Wisp of the Old Gods. Is he just going to try and jam it early and just hope that there's no answer, hope that the swipes are in the bottom half of the deck, or is he going to try and go long-term with it, buff them up to 2/2s immediately with the Power of the Wild?
Right now he picks up Azure Drake and swipe. I was about to make the point that this deck from Pascoa, usually the more recent Malagos Druid decks, do not run Blood Mage Thaunos. They right. They have sort of that Gadgetzan Auctioneer, I think, is the card for card swap.
Yeah, sure.
Sometimes Emperor Thorsan is the card for card swap, one of those six drops. So he has less of a chance to get Azure Drake swipe, but picking up the Azure Drake is a big deal. And now he's got to make the decision, well, do I play Azure Drake with the five mana that I have left, or do I just use the second Feral Rage and take the four damage here? Or I suppose three damage after the hero power to remove the rest of this Druid of the Claw.
I mean, that Drake swipe combination does just look so appealing if you're Pascoa in this situation, right? He knows that Power of the Wild is a huge win condition in this matchup, making 2/2 tokens. So yeah, I respect this option a lot. I mean, I think he's visualizing the long-term texture of this matchup and saying, hey, I've dealt with both Violet Teachers here. So one of the only things that is scary to me is a big buff, immediately buffed Wisps of the Old Gods, and now he has a long-term answer available to him with the Azure Drake for it.
Roof Trellin, as you talked about, realizes that he's the aggressor in the matchup, and he's just going to use that Power of the Wild early just to make a 3-2. Again, I think this is going to try and be a swipe test.
Agreed. But is it enough? I mean, can you convincingly say here if your opponent does not swipe that they do not have swipe in their hand? I mean, if you cannot do that, then what good is it as a test, right? But we will see here from Pasqua whether he takes the bait or not. But that Malakos pickup with the amount of mana that Pasqua has available to him is a really big deal if he can pick up a burn spell or two to go with it.
Malakos plus swipe. If you can make that happen in any sort of combo, whether it be Emperor Thorsan or multiple Innervates, is probably the greatest feeling that you can have in a game of Hearthstone.
Yeah.
Doing that much damage to everything on the board and your opponent's face, something that cannot be matched.
Yeah, so this is the situation now for Roof Trellin. He played out his swipeable board last turn. He did not see a swipe come out, but you still see not enough confidence to just go ahead and just jam the 1-1s on the board. So you have to question the validity of the swipe check, I guess. Like, what did it really do for him if he's not in a position now where he believes himself that the swipe is not there?
Yeah, and an interesting choice by Roof Trellin. He really feels like he needs more cards. So he cycles both of his rats and uses Savage Roar to effectively deal 6 points of damage yep. that he can split up for 3 mana, which is actually a lot of value out of that card. And it was one of the things that I talked about him with earlier in the week. I was like, Double Savage Roar is really risky because you're saying to your opponent that you're going to have a board at some point in the game. Mm-hmm. And he said, sometimes it's just good even with one minion. If one token survives, sometimes I'm happy with just that.
That Fandral pickup is a potentially huge deal here. I don't think Pasqua can get too greedy with the Malakos value here. The Fandral coin Living Roots here looks like a great way to fight himself back onto this board.
Allow him to kill off the Panther.
Yep.
From Power of the Wild. I don't think he can really, like you said, get greedy with it and try and go for one turn kill or whatever. Trellin's still very healthy. Trellin also is sort of out of resources, and Pasqua has kept that removal, has kept that swipe for the very situation that Roof Trellin is going to try and use to come back in the game, I think. Maybe Roof Trellin just tries to hold on to the Wisps until... Whoa. Okay. Okay, I guess not.
Yeah, does that change the equation, TJ? Now suddenly the risk reward tree is just massive. With the second Savage Roar drawn, if there is no swipe, which Nourish has just been cast, so Pasqua very, very entitled to have a swipe in his hand right now. If there is no swipe right now, the game is just over because of that Savage Roar draw. So I definitely don't fault the line here from Roof Trellin to go for it. The Moonfire picked up as well means that Pasqua is actually representing a ton of damage himself since he can play the swipe alongside the Malakos with the double innovate.
I would actually go for the Malakos right now because it puts a situation where you might be able to end the game before turn 10. People, there's a lot of...
Doesn't Emperor just do that better, though? You load more power onto the board right now, and you potentially give yourself more burst options from the Malakos and don't expose it to a mulch in the long term.
Yeah, you're right. No, you're right. That's very true. And the 5 power of Emperor Thorsan.
Yeah, exactly.
You look at Malakos, I was thinking, wow, Malakos is just such a big minion.
Yeah.
It's going to hit hard, but Emperor Thorsan actually hits harder. So, yeah, you're right.
Yeah, so Emperor and Swipe the Face this turn pushes another 4, and then he is sat with Malakos Moonfire in hand with a cycle for 1 mana on the following turn that can pick up any source of damage because they'll have so much mana available. But Pasqua is going to go with the swipe option right now, which I guess does it push damage because he's buffing the swipe immediately. He's getting that +5 off the swipe, which would be cast either way this turn. So I guess, either way puts him in a pretty good spot to end the game.
Yeah, I think this one pushes the most damage this turn.
Yeah.
Is why he went for it. Maybe Emperor would push more damage in the long run because he could also play another spell that he drew next turn and it wouldn't expose him to swipe. Or it wouldn't expose him to mulch, I'm sorry. He does get the Moonfire value out this turn, which I do agree with. So Starfire is going to be the pickup. And Pasqua is just a single spell draw away from ending this game. And he's got Yogg coming next turn. And he's got to have that in the back of his head, so he's going to want to end the game right now.
Yeah, any source of damage here from Pasqua, essentially, that's not going to be good enough. Drake, he can be played here. Still pick up Swipe, still pick up Living Roots, still pick up Moonfire number 2. Wrath is not good enough. Another recycle with the Wild Growth. This takes Swipe number 2 out of the equation, but the Moonfire and the Living Roots are still there. Doesn't get it. Wrath to cycle still.
Yeah, and it's a wrath for six to cycle. So he could purposefully damage his own Malygos, but I don't know if that's worth the risk. I think the value of having Malygos on the board as opposed to going for like the 1 in 12, maybe something along those lines to pick up the second point of burn. So, oh wow,
oh,
and he picks up the innervate. That's so huge.
That is so big.
Three extra spells on this Yogg-Saron, and Pasqua is going to see this innervate, and he's going to know exactly what's about to hit him. Roof Troll nodding his head in approval.
The cards in hand are green.
He probably killed himself.
Yeah.
I don't want to be a spoiler here, but
I mean, someone died. This is a bug that you often see in the situation where too many things light up green for it to make logical sense. It usually means that someone is dead, and the number one candidate for that right now is Roof Trellin.
He's at 1 health, so a single spell that can deal damage to a random player that goes away.
Dead. Unfortunately, Bash does not keep you alive. Armor is not enough. You need to have some health. So although that breaks even overall, it was enough to finish him off in the end. And his good buddy, Yogg-Saron, decided that fate was not in his corner that game and delivered the killing blow himself.
For the second time in the series as well, Yogg's had been sort of duds so far in the series. But that gives Pasqua the edge. And we're going to get into game number 6 momentarily, right after this. Welcome back, everybody. About to jump into game number 6 of Pasqua versus Roof Trellin. And Pasqua is up 3-2. Only deck he has left to win with is that Freeze Mage. So far in the series, he's 0-2 with the deck, Sottl.
He is, and I made the point earlier that this is a man who designed his lineup, purely through theory craft and science and calculating win rates, making reads on what his opponents were going to play, and yet somehow he still came to the decision that his pet deck, his favorite deck, was correct to bring. So, I do beg the question whether that was a little moment of his heart ruling his head, and whether it'll come back to bite him here, because still the potential for this Freeze Mage to fall flat 2 more times is very possible.
Time will tell. The last two decks for Roof Trellin are the Druid deck, Token Druid that we saw, and of course, the Control Shaman, which a deck that had a big splash at the preliminary, but since then has sort of fallen out of favor for a lot of players that, once thought it was incredibly powerful.
Yeah, and this particular build of the Druid is a scary deck to face as the Freeze Mage, honestly, because with double Savage Roar in the list, you will feel, as the Freeze Mage player, that fear equity situation that you talked about earlier with George C, because of the presence of double Savage Roar, you will feel that any time you miss a freeze, you are going to be under threat of losing your block once a board gets generated. So, Pasqua said to both of us that he is a very statistics-driven player and that he calculates the odds and he makes the correct plays based on, likely outcomes. So we'll have to see if that is the case here or whether he gets too scared by the presence of those Savage Roars and just reacts too early to board states.
Indeed, both players decent starts here. Pasqua does have some early draw, and he's got more draw to back it up. Roof Trellin got a ton of early ramp, having both Wild Growth and Mire Keeper. So he's going to be off to a great start. But Emperor Thorsand into Alexstrasza. That could end games pretty quick.
It sure can. What is Roof Trellin playing in this list in terms of healing? I do not see a great deal looking at that list, TJ.
Zero. He plays in the 3-slot double Savage Roar in a single Mulch, as opposed to the sometimes double Feral Rage that we see in Malygos lists. And no Moonglade Portal, as it doesn't really fit in a deck like this that wants to get on board and capitalize. But yeah, it's going to be tough. Going to be real tough. Does have Raven Idols. Raven Idols can always put a wrench in some of the situations for Freeze Mage, but Roof Trellin, if given the choice, probably going to opt to go more aggressive with those cards.
Yeah, more than likely. And as I mentioned, healing is a secondary byproduct a lot of the time. What matters more than anything is pressure. And Roof Trellin has pressure for days in his hand. Both Fandral and Violet Teacher, both the power 4-drops. He also has burst damage in the form of Living Roots and Druid of the Claw, potentially in charge form. So he has everything he needs to push a lot of initiative here and just essentially race Pasqua to that turn 9 that he has with the Emperor Alexstrasza combination.
The big thing here, I think, is to not go overboard with the fan drill. The one thing is you want to try and protect these boards, and I like not going with the Wrath and making the trade here, because Fandral Wrath is going to be a big way that you can deal with Doomsayers should they come out, say, with a Frost Nova or a Blizzard. So
well, also just saving the Wrath right now also means if Frost Nova Doomsayer were to come out on curve, he has Druid of the Claw charge plus Wrath to be able to deal with the 7. So yeah, I definitely wants to save the Wrath here. That's exactly the consideration he has. He's making his first big push. It will get shut down by Frost Nova Doomsayer, but he's made sure to hold back the answer from hand to deal with that situation.
And this is a very threatening board. You talked about it earlier. Savage Roar makes the turns from Pasqual very difficult, because he has to find a balance between what can I play around and what do I have to respect.
I mean, there is, what, 6, 9 damage in play right now. Savage Roar would add an additional 12. So this would be 21 damage next turn if he allows a Savage Roar to go off without dealing with any of the board. That is a terrifying proposition. When you're a Freeze Mage player, that's just all about time. All about finding turns for yourself to set up your own win conditions. And Pasqual just decides he has to respect the long-term threat of the Violet Teacher, uses the Fireball to take care of it, and realizes that, you know, this isn't a matchup like the Paladin matchup we saw previously, where every single burn card is valuable to him. He has burn to spare in the deck in this matchup, especially with Alexstrasza already in his hand.
Fandral going to come down, and a Wrath as well. A little bit interesting, because it seemed like just the Power of the Wild would have been sort of enough, I suppose. But well, Rubtralon wants to push as much damage as he possibly can this turn.
Right. Essentially, that Wrath connected to face for 2 damage, right? Because it stopped one extra attack having to go into the 2-2, into the 0-2 taunt.
Wrath the face, you say?
It's possible. The forbidden techniques.
Well, Rubtralon now has Wisps of the Old Gods. In case his port does get Blizzard, he can effectively refill and buff his existing cards that remain after the Blizzard with a single card. Also, he'll get double value from the Raven Idol. Ooh. Start with 1. Find healing minions, could find healing spells, could find captured Jormungars.
Could find a Venture Co. mercenary. All right, so this is a break point here for Rubtralon. Is he just playing for the aggression, or is he playing for sustain? I love the decision to pick up the Savage Roar here. He knows he has just amassed a ton of pressure in this matchup. There is no need for him to be too worried about, you know, healing in this matchup. He just needs to push through damage, but from the other side, I guess there's an argument to say, like, hey, is the Savage Roar needed right now? Like, do I really need to use it to push extra damage? Am I not better off with a little bit of security?
So a very threatening board, and Rubtralon's base said you have to have the answer. And Pasqual does have the answer. He's got the Flamestrike, removes everything off the board except for the Fandral. But the Fandral's the most threatening of those minions, so at least Rubtralon will still have the value from that. Finds the second Wisps!
There may actually be lethal outs here with the Raven Idol. No, he won't have any additional mana available to him after Druid of the Claw and Savage Roar. So yeah, I'm sure we are. It's the same decision. I'm sure we're gonna see a Wisp of the Old Gods come out here, and this is just so punishing. This is a brutal draw. I mentioned this is a terrifying build to play against for the Freeze Mage.
But now his board is full for the Doomsayer. The thing is, he does have a way to deal with it, and I think that's what the bite was for. Bite is sort of halfway in between Portal and Savage Roar, because you still get a little bit of extra damage.
I mean, you can also argue that 4 armor is better than 6 health against Freeze Mage.
Yeah, it allows you to go above the original threshold of 30 that you'd be able to, so. Rubtralon, what is he? I don't even know what he was doing there. Oh, man, what a character. But yeah, he has a way to deal with Doomsayer, and that's probably the play that Pasqual has to go with, is the Frost Nova into Doomsayer.
Yeah, I mean, he doesn't have a block developed, so he can use his remaining 3 mana to do that as well, which can potentially set up a win condition him with the offensive Alexstrasza. And you can see here how fragile some of the matchups with Freeze Mage are, because if that bite wasn't taken, if there wasn't damage picked up in hand to potentially deal with this Doomsayer, this matchup, despite being looking incredibly one-sided for the entire game, could just swing right back on his head. And that is a snap call on the bite from Rubtralon.
Yeah, and swipe picked up is actually a big deal, because it allows him to hold on to Savage Roar. Not that it would matter with how much damage that he has on the board, but yeah, actually, who cares?
Just in case this 26 damage that was in play wasn't enough.
Yeah. So Pasqua gonna go with the I'm gonna just Alshazi in the face and hope I draw enough damage. But Roof Trellin is going to go for the play here. I guess this allows him to more cleanly. No, he would have had enough anyway.
Yeah. I'm not entirely sure why we were Savage Roaring this game.
Oh, he could win! He's got Eater of Secrets! What Eater of Secrets? I didn't even notice!
Wait, were we too busy talking about Venture Co. Mercenaries to notice there was a damn Eater of Secrets in his hand?
Yep.
Wow.
Well,
TJ, what happened?
That was the first time I've actually ever seen Eater of Secrets used in competitive play to actually win a game against Freeze Mage. Mm-hmm.
Very, very possibly. I mean, that card is just not good. You would have to be playing against something like 75% Freeze Mage on ladder to be considering putting that card in your deck.
I was wondering, like, isn't he going to pop the block at a weird amount? And I was like, oh, what's that 2/4 that's got a purplish color to it? But yeah, a fancy win for Roof Trellin as he ties up the series at 3 games apiece. We're going to jump into game number 7 right after this. Time for game number 7 of the series between Pasqua and Roof Trellin. It's been back and forth all the way through, and it comes down to a very interesting matchup, and that matchup is going to be Freeze Mage for Pasqua versus a Control Shaman for Roof Trellin.
Yeah, and it's a matchup that it's going to be difficult for the Shaman to generate a whole lot of early pressure in. They do have that same sort of burst healing that the Paladin has access to, the N'Zoth Paladin that he played in the opening matchup of the series. So it's, again, more than likely going to come down to how much time the Freeze Mage has to amass, you know, critical mass in their hand and generate that huge burst damage combo. But Roof Trellin will just be desperately scrambling to generate some pressure on the board in the earlier turns.
This matchup effectively comes down to how quickly the Shaman can find Ragnaros the Fire Lord.
It seems that way, yeah.
Because this deck does not put on much pressure at all. Mm-mm. And Freeze Mage will kill you in one turn if you give them all of the time to draw into the spells that they need. So Roof Trellin is definitely going to be trying to find that. He's going to be trying to find some of the big minions that can amount to pressure. So... and he gets it forced. No way.
That is insane. He is coining that bad boy out next turn. That is a turn 4 Ragnaros, an 8/8 Ragnaros, not a 1/1 Ragnaros that has come from a Barnes, which is the conventional method that we are now used to on turn 4. That is a legitimate full-size, grown-up, big boy Ragnaros Fire Lord coming out in the most important matchup to have a Ragnaros Fire Lord in your deck on turn 4.
And the Blood Imp's going to bring it up to 9 health.
I misspoke, an 8/9 Ragnaros. My bad.
And another big thing here is that he picks up the Hex off the top to deal with the... Oh, well, 2 Doomsayers is tough. Well, actually, that might just be the counter.
I mean, that's a big deal.
Double Doomsayer to mirror image. This is ridiculous. This game is absurd.
I mean, he can Hex one, try and snipe the other. That's a possibility.
It's a 1 in 5, though. It's a 1 in 5.
Right. Do you know what the odds of drawing exactly Ragnaros off the far side were? A lot worse than 1 in 5. Roof Trellin is a dreamer, okay?
So what does he need with this?
This does not help him.
Oh, he was hoping for Ancestral Spirit.
That's very true. Or Hex number 2 would have done the job as well.
How would that work with double Doomsayer and Social Spirit, though?
Well, the first Doomsayer kills the second Doomsayer, so they don't actually both go off.
I gotcha, yeah. Well, now this Ragnaros is going to die a very early death.
And that, you know, as huge as the Ragnaros draw was, the fact that it is now dealt with is equally huge because... Where does this deck now find its remaining 22 damage to start pressuring ice blocks?
Let's look at the threats that are in this deck. We
sure.
have Emperor Thorstand, we have Things from Below, we have Bog Creepers, mm-hmm. and Earth Elementals, and that's effectively it.
Yep.
Now, those threats are pretty big in themselves, but it takes a long time for those to come out, and there's not that many minions in the deck. You can see Roof Trellin already has a lot of dead cards. in his hand. So Pasqua does have quite a bit of time to find all that burn.
Does indeed. And Loot Hoarder picked up right on time. He just ran himself out of cycle a little bit there. He's going to ping away one health on the 5-5, take it down to a 5-4, which is telegraphing Flame Strike in the hand to an extent. But Roof Trellin has got another, you know, powerful, aggressive minion here to stick to the board. So he is continuing the initiative that he picked up with that Ragnaros early. And the Bog Creeper on curve is exactly what he's looking for.
Pasqua has used both of his Doomsayers, so now I suppose Roof Trellin's board is protected. So even though Rag's not around anymore, it still was a lot of resources used.
Right.
But, I mean, now it's Roof Trellin's going to lose this Bog Creeper unless he draws an Ancestral Spirit. Faces Manipulator on one of these is not really going to do much. Earth Elemental ends up being pretty good, though.
Earth Elemental's a good pickup. That's just another huge minion, but Pasqua does have the freeze effects in hand here. But as you said, with the Doomsayers gone, these huge minions that are coming out turn after turn from Roof Trellin are not going to go away very quickly. So this is a race against time here for Pasqua, essentially. He's going to have to cycle his deck, which fortunately for him, he's picking up cycle cards on the right-hand side every single turn here. For the last couple of turns, which is what he needs, because the rest of his hand doesn't really get him anywhere right now. So this is going to be a little bit of a cycle here of the Freeze Mage of just freeze your board and draw a card for as many turns as they can continue to do that. There's the Alex. That changes things enormously.
Alexstrasza. The healing in the Shaman deck is much less than the Paladin. So you can opt to go for those types of things. I guess you sort of have Halazeal, but not nearly a board full of minions to be able to activate it fully. And it looks like Roof Trellin's going to try and go for just the pressure plan onto the board.
Yep. I mean, I like it. This really is all aggression that is being backed up by that huge Ragnaros early on. And he's just been able to pick up enough of those huge threats left in the remainder of his deck to keep the pressure up. And Pasqua very, very quickly just running out of options here.
Yeah, Roof Trellin sort of wincing. He used Lava Shock before he totemed up, so he effectively missed a damage.
He did.
Pasqua, I don't know, you might think that's on purpose because this not having spell power might make him be able to pop the block more easily at one.
Nice cover, TJ.
But yeah, it you could tell that he just didn't even think about that.
Yeah, yeah.
He thinks it's an error.
Right.
But who knows what's actually correct? Because I might have even held off to try and leave him at 8, so that I could pop the block more easily.
That's a very good point.
Yeah. And maybe it's even better to ping yourself in a situation. Okay, that I'm getting a little too deep.
We are fast approaching Oskaka versus Tice levels of Freeze Mage health manipulation.
Yeah.
But now both healing waves have been drawn, which will pay very quickly to any aggressive Alexstrasza plan that Pasqua might have in the back of his mind here, which means he is very rapidly running out of time. Sylvanas is free to be developed. We talked in previous series about the threats of Doomsayers being used to counter Sylvanas, but both Doomsayers used in that same turn just to take care of that 5-mana Ragnaros that was drawn. So Pasqua now has to decide, is this the turn? Do I just have to go? He doesn't even really have the damage to back it up afterwards. Looks like he's struggling to find that one extra turn that he needs. No matter what line he goes down here, it just seems like he falls one turn short based on the board that he's staring down.
And also afraid of, if he goes for Alexstrasza, there's two things that could happen. Either he heals out of range of burn that he would draw, or he just doesn't draw into the burn that he needs.
Yep. Or, third option, an Eater of Secrets appears out of literally nowhere.
Which seemed like it last time, of course, it did appear from the Fandrilled Raven Idol.
Yeah.
And we just sort of glossed over it. But alas, it made its appearance in a big way. No Raven Idols in this deck, though. We can look at it. There's no Eater Secrets tucked away.
So Emperor Frostnova does look like the most solid line. This will potentially now give him the 1-2 punch of the Alexstrasza into burn. He can now fit all of that burn into a single turn after the Alex. So in his mind, at least, this gives him a potential win condition of some of the healing not being there for Roof Trellin. We can see, of course, with Caster Vision that strategy is not going to work out, but Pasqua knows here that with the Doomsayers gone, with these huge Earth Elementals having the revive effect on them from the Ancestral Spirit, this board is just not going anywhere. So he does not have the time to try and amass an OTK here. He knows he's going to have to go sooner rather than later.
Mm-hmm. Very true. And does not, I mean, this matchup's looking really tough because Roof Trellin didn't give him time. Even though he was able to kill the rag early, it did 8 damage. It bought a whole turn for Roof Trellin, as well as 3 resources. 2 being sort of Kia, I suppose, with the double Doomsayer.
Mm-hmm.
But it really just bought time, and that's sort of what Roof Trellin needed. If you give Pascoa 1 less turn to draw cards, or 2 less turns to draw cards, if you're factoring the damage, that could be what matters in the game.
Yeah, so the Blood Mage being picked up, of course, as we mentioned again in the Paladin match that came previously, is a key component of any OTK-type strategy that you do want to embark on here, but still nowhere close. He's looking at, 15 damage in hand with the 4 burn spells plus another 4 from the Blood Mage, so he's just not even scratching the surface of the damage he needs.
So is it better to try and force some healing out now by going with something like Blood Mage plus double Forgotten Torch with Loot Hoarder, because it puts extra burn in your deck, and you also make Roof Trellin feel a little bit less comfortable about leaving himself in the health total. So you sort of bait out a healing wave and then follow up with Alexstrasza plus the burn. Does he have time for that is another thing.
But I mean, if he does Blood Mage plus Forgotten Torch in this, the double Forgotten Torch in this situation, he's not even setting up lethal for himself next turn. So even if the healing isn't there, like what is the reward for that play, right? It's just not even there. So
it'd have to be a bait, effectively.
Yeah, exactly. For some healing to come down, but then he would lose his block on the same turn, and he just hasn't set himself up a win condition. So this line with the Alexstrasza is just the only thing I see here. There is 14 healing. He has potentially 14 more to spare with healing wave number 2. And the block is going to go down here. The Hex Frog can be removed with the Lava Shock that is in hand. And yeah, this is just going to spell the end for Pascoa here. I just don't see the way out for Freeze Mage. I don't see the turns that he needs to make something happen.
And Roof Trellin just going to set up an even bigger wall. He's going to have both Earth Elementals spawn back when they die, plus the thing from below. Pascoa's not attacking face anytime soon with the limited amount of minions he has. And he does draw into Ice Lance, which is extra burn, but still nowhere even close to what he needs. Has to have Ice Block right now.
That's not it. He doesn't find it. I don't think he has 3 sources of freeze that can lock out 3 attacks on the board, but there is still that remaining 1-1, so he is going to go ahead and deal with his own Blood Mage here, looking again for exactly Ice Block, which is just purely buying a turn. Doesn't find it. The Roaring Torch goes to the face. And for Pasqua, the feel-good story, the Hearthstone redemption story, has come to an end, and it is Roof Trellin that will progress.
But they sort of a refreshing deck lineup as well. Lots of control decks. Went all the way to game number 7, but ultimately Pasqua couldn't get it done with the Freeze Mage, which lost him all 4 matches in that series.
Yeah, and again, you have to go back to those deck building decisions. You know, I said that Pasqua felt that he had the tournament won purely on the deck building process. The lineups were just in his favor. He'd brought the best decks, but you know, did his heart overrule his head on that Freeze Mage pick, and did it end up costing him in the end?
All right, well, we do have the bold deck builder himself, Roof Trellin, the winner of that series, standing by on stage with That's Admirable.
I'm joined by our 3rd semifinalist, Roof Trellin, in a crazy 7-game set that you just played. You know, there's so many spots I could ask you about here, so I'm just going to ask it to you the best way I can. What do you feel was the most critical point in this match?
Definitely, like, once I started, after I lost with my mage, once I started getting back on track with, like, really good draws, because I feel like my draws with my first mage losses were, like, really bad. So yeah, basically once I started drawing well, the luck favored me.
Yeah, it certainly did. Well, I want to wish you a congratulations on this and good luck in your next match. But our fourth match of the day is coming up to decide our fourth semifinalist.